Hey guys, so this is gonna be your review of yeast breads. And so I have my Culinary Institute of America yeast bread recipe that I've been modifying for years. You can see that my last modification was 2016. You can find this in your files section of Teams. Most recipes you will find are not versatile, as you can't use them in a multitude of ways. Most recipes are like, use it for like one thing, especially when it comes to like breads. You can't like a good baguette doesn't make a good Italian bread or a good pita, or you have to use different recipes for different products. Well, this recipe kind of goes against the grain of that. So this recipe is their standard yeast bread recipe, but it makes good or better than good products in a bunch of different ways. So if you see that, like, up here I have times one and times two, so this is one times the recipe, that's two times the recipe. Here are the ingredients. There's four ingredients: water, yeast, bread, salt. I have a bunch of washes up top. I have the dough procedure, and then after you finish the dough procedure, you can make baguettes or rolls, or you can make bread bowls, because everybody loves New England clam chowder and a bread bowl. You can make pizza, or you can make tomato pie. Now, I will say that the pizza for this isn't too great. I would go with Chef Bozo's pizza dough recipe, but what we're gonna do today is tomato pie. So the first thing that we're gonna do is start out with the front and just make the regular dough procedure, and we're gonna times it by two. And half of it will go to tomato pie, and then we'll see what the other half is gonna go into. Okay, so let's get started. So I have my four ingredients here, and I have a scale. Now, I know that some of you don't have a scale at home, but if you look at the recipe, I also put the volume measurements there. Now, these are not going to be as exact as doing mass, but at home, you know, it's gonna get you darn close. So I'm gonna put my, you're gonna have to trust me on this, because I tried to move my camera around to so you could see what I'm doing, and I just couldn't get a good angle. So here we have the bowl, and it's on the scale, and I'm gonna hit tear, and the scale doesn't keep saying this, which means that the, there we go. So I'm gonna put the bowl on. If you ever see that, it normally means that the batteries are running dead. So I am going to hit tear. It now says 0 ounces. I am going to add 20 ounces of bread flour. So let's start with that. And this is bread flour, which is not all-purpose flour. All-purpose flour doesn't have the structure to do what you need to do for this recipe, because bread flour has more gluten. That's a good Nocti question. The, of the three flours, bread flour, or the three main flours, bread flour has the most gluten, cake flour has the least gluten, and all-purpose flour is right in the middle. Okay, so now at this point, I have my flour done, and that is exactly 20 ounces. So I'm gonna tear again. Now we need to add salt to that, because this is the dry team, and you can kind of see what I'm doing right now. So I have it on there, I'm gonna hit tear, and we need to add 12 grams of salt. If your salt is a little lumpy, just break it up a little bit. This kosher salt is lumpy because there's no preservatives in it, which is part of the reason that I really like it. And actually, it would help if I switched over to grams. The nice thing about this scale is you can switch from one to the other without it being, without losing where you're at. So I have my, I'm gonna just break it up a little bit. I have my 12 grams of salt, put that there. We're already halfway done with our ingredients. Lastly, we're gonna mix our water and our yeast. And I normally do this first. I don't know why I'm doing it second, and that gives the yeast time to bloom. So basically, this is dehydrated yeast. And what happens is when you mix it with the water, it rehydrates, and then it starts making carbon dioxide and ethyl alcohol. It starts releasing it. And so what we're gonna do right now is I am going to measure out, I'm gonna measure out 13 ounces of water. And I like to use liquid measuring cups for this just because it has a nice pour spout on it. And my water is somewhere, and see, I have a little bit too much, so all I have to do is pour it back. So the nice thing about this is you have a pour spout, you can pour it back and forth. My water is somewhere between 105 and 115 degrees, which is exactly where you wanna be. And you're like, chef, how do you know that? I use a thermometer. And the nice thing about schools is that by law, you know, they can't have their water too hot. So basically what happens is most of the time the water coming out of the tap is almost exactly the perfect temperature. Now at your house, that probably isn't the case. So I have my water here, which is measured to 13 ounces. And now lastly, I need my yeast. So I'm gonna bring this back to grams. I got a little lump in there. And so what I'm gonna do is I am going to measure out 5 grams of yeast. And you can hear Fred in the back talking during my video. And now it's, for some reason it was reading wrong, so I'm just gonna start over. 4 and 5, okay. And then all that we're gonna do is we are gonna add the yeast to the water. And now I'm gonna mix this up and we're gonna wait approximately, and we don't need to weigh it for this, but we're gonna wait about 5 minutes until it is bloomed, okay? So I'll see you in 5 minutes. Okay, so you can see that 5 minutes has passed and now it has become one with the water. Sometimes it will foam. This is the yeast that has been here at Eastern since March, so I'm really just hoping it's not dead. But we'll find out, right? If it doesn't rise, it didn't work. So now we have to take the wet ingredients and add them to the dry ingredients, but you see what there is, salt. And salt controls yeast and it can limit yeast. And so what we really wanna do is before we start is we're just gonna mix that salt in. And so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take all the water, I'm gonna pour it in. And now I'm not using a stand mixer yet because I want to show you how to do this without a mixer in case any of you don't have that at home. I'm going to switch to a mixer in a minute for the kneading just because I don't have time to stand over it and knead it for that long. Okay, so I like to do almost like the fold-in method where I turn the bowl and I just push it toward the center. I find that mixing, this is the best way to mix almost anything because it doesn't make a huge mess and doesn't make it like flop all over the place. And you're going to keep mixing this. And what's going to happen is it's going to look really dry. And for those of you who have not made that many yeast breads, what you're going to say to yourself is it's too dry. It needs water. But that's really not the case. Because this is what's called a shaggy dough. Like if you ever hear someone use that expression, shaggy dough, be like, I have no idea what they're talking about. This is it. So let me grab some gloves and let me show you what to do with your shaggy dough, because some of you are going to be like, add water. And what you're going to do is if you add water right now, you're going to ruin your dough. So let me grab some gloves. I'll be back in a minute. So I have my gloves on and what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the shaggy dough and I'm going to pour it right onto the counter. And you can see how much flour is left in the bowl, and that's okay. But what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna get all of the shaggy dough, all of the flour and everything out onto the counter. Because whenever you're cooking, especially when you're baking, you're working with ratios. See, nothing left. So how much water to how much flour to how much yeast to how much salt, like it all matters. Like everything has a different function. And so I'm gonna try and get as much as I can off of this rubber spatula. And now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna knead this stuff together. So I'm just gonna kind of push it together and I'm gonna start kneading and I'm gonna press with my palms. I'm gonna turn it, look, it's already coming together. I'm gonna turn it over and press with my palms and I'm gonna keep turning. And then what's gonna happen is this dough is gonna come together. And see, it's already coming together. And this is why you didn't wanna add any more water. I'm gonna just keep pushing everything back in. Here we go. Now at this point, we have made a nice dough, but it's not kneaded yet. You can see how like rough it is. It's not smooth. Like a nice dough is nice and smooth, easy to work with. Right now this is like getting super elastic the more that I knead it. And we need to work that gluten to develop structure. So the more carbon dioxide and ethyl alcohol it creates, the more bubbles it creates and the more it will catch and the more structure for the bread. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put this aside for a second. I'm gonna grab my mixer and try and put it in a place that you can see it. I grabbed this from Chef Ben's side. I'm gonna put my dough inside. And I'm going to put the dough hook on. Snap it in, the dough hook on it, and then bring this up, and we're gonna plug it in. And then what we're gonna do is we're gonna start out on low. And that's more of like a medium low. And now we're just gonna let this mix for about 3 minutes, if I'm correct. Yes, so it wants us to mix it for about 3 minutes. 3 to 6 minutes is always good. If it's not slapping the dough against the side of the bowl, if it's just stuck on the dough hook, you wanna speed it up so centrifugal force throws it away from the hook. And that will help it, like I'm gonna go up a little bit more. There we go. And I will see you in 3 minutes. Okay, so timer's going off. I'll stop the mixer, lower it down. And so now what we're gonna do, let me move this out of the way so you can see what I'm doing. It looks like a nice dough. I'm gonna get it off the dough hook. It should slide right off. Now, if you measured correctly, and I should have said this earlier, your dough is gonna feel really good. And you know you have a nice dough, and this is a way to tell. If you touch it, it feels moist to the touch. It feels nice, you know, but it doesn't stick to you if you touch it very quickly. If you touch it for like more than a second and then it sticks to you, that's a nice dough. That's how you know you have perfect hydration. Okay, now there's other doughs that are like pizza doughs that should have more hydration, like Chef Vozo's dough, and that will stick to you no matter what. But you work with them differently. Okay, so what we are going to do right now is I'm just gonna take this dough out. I'm gonna use some cooking spray. I'm going to round this dough, you know, treat it kind of like a jellyfish. I'm gonna put it in the bottom of the bowl. I'm gonna spray the bowl or spray the dough. I'm gonna take some plastic wrap. And this is how I like it. This is called tenting. So I am going to go one way. And unfortunately, the cutter is not in the right area for this. So let's try that again. We're gonna go one way. And then I'm gonna spin this, and then we're gonna go the other way. Because the last thing we want is for this dough to dry out. And so then all I'm gonna do is push this down and then let it come up the sides. So it's going to kind of like raise the tent as it rises. And so I'm gonna let this rise for 30 minutes. See you then. Hi, so if you've noticed, my venue has changed. It turns out that when you let yeast sit at Eastern from March until September, that it could die, which is why you should always keep your yeast in a refrigerator. Somehow someone left it out on the spice shelf and it was dead. So my dough did not rise. So I made another dough exactly the same. It has risen for 30 minutes. So we're exactly in the place that we left off. And so it has about doubled in size. So it has been another 30 minutes and you can see that our dough has doubled in size yet again. And that's pretty much a good way to tell if your dough is fully risen, is if it has doubled in size. And so what we're gonna do is we are going to pull the plastic off again and we're gonna punch it down. And you can see now it's even bigger. We have more new yeast cells. The dough is even softer. It's breaking down those, well, we developed gluten strands and now it's just making them soft and more digestible. And so I'm just pushing it in like a jellyfish. Gonna take it up. This is called rounding. You can see how like tacky it is. And then all I'm gonna do, actually, I'm going to give this a little spray one last time. I'm gonna put this inside. I'm gonna give the top a spray. Now, realistically, this is ready to be portioned, but the problem is that because we just redistributed all of the new yeast cells, the dough is worked, which means that it's going to be very elastic and it's not going to do what we want it to do. So we have to let it rest one more time. And it sounds crazy, but by letting it rest, it means that it's going to relax. And then when we come back in 15 minutes, we're going to be able to manipulate it way easier. If you ever have a yeast dough that is just like springing back and very elastic, like just walk away for 15 minutes and come back and it will be like a completely different dough. Okay, so I will see you in 15 minutes. Hi, so yes, I'm back at school. And I'm back at school because I did not really like the way my tomato pie came out last night. And it turns out that when you don't do something for a couple of years, you lose a little bit of skill. And so in that video or that, in that part of this video, I did another method of how to get it on the half sheet pan, which is more of like oil stretching. And I'm gonna put that at the end of the video. So if you want, you can see another way, which gives you a more rustic, if you're not used to doing it, it will give you a more of a rustic appeal. So it's more wavy because you don't knock out all of the bubbles that you created. I'm going to do a more standard restaurant version of this. So you can do either method and they're both acceptable. This is just the prettier, in quotation marks, way of doing it. Okay, so this has rested for 15 minutes. Yet again, at this point, you do not want to overwork your dough. So before, you could work it and work it and work it and it didn't really matter. But at this point, the last thing you want to do is knead it or punch, you know, well, you can punch it down. But I want you to know that I'm going to be so careful with it that I'm not even going to punch it down in the bowl. Because if you punch it down in the bowl and you fold it over, well, you've already lost. Then you need to let it rest again. And if you find that when you start working with it and it's not like, I can already see that this is, see how it's like springing back, it probably could rest longer. So what I might do is at some point in the video, I might stop and just let it rest. But all you're gonna do is we're going to, and that will make it like a relax. So I'm just gonna, yeah. You can see if it has a lot of spring to it, it hasn't rested long enough because we developed a lot of gluten. And so at this point, this is a really good example. We don't want it to spring back. We want it to come here. So I can do one of two things. And what I'll probably do is just give it a quick. I'm gonna cover it back up. And actually, let me use some new. And then what's gonna happen is we're just gonna let it bench proof, or bench rest in this case, for about another 10 minutes. And I bet you in 10 minutes it's going to work a lot better. So here we go. Make sure no air can get to it. See you in 10 minutes. It's been 10 minutes, and so let's see how we're doing. Oh yeah. See, it's bringing back a little bit, but much better. So we're just gonna give it a little bit of flour. This is not the best table to be doing this. It's a very springy table, so I'm sorry for the noise. And now periodically I just flip it over, because what's gonna happen is as you work with this, look at all those bubbles popping, is it's gonna soak up this flour. And don't douse it, just like give it what it needs. If you can put your hands on it or put it on the table without it sticking, like, and you can kind of slide it around, well then you're fine. If it starts sticking, then add a little more. Okay, so my goal is to get it to be the same size as the pan. Whenever you roll something, my method is start in the center and don't go for broke, don't press. You're gonna go up and don't roll off the edge. Go to the edge, but not off of it. And I'm gonna put it back in the middle. I'm gonna roll down. And you're like, chef, it's bigger than the pan. You want it slightly bigger than the pan. And then I'll show you how, what I call fudging it back. And then what I do is I turn it to the side and I'm gonna go up, and then I'm gonna go down, and I'm gonna go down. And this is gonna give us a nice even dough, which is really nice. Okay, we're getting there. So now we're gonna spin it back, and you see, as long as it slides, we're okay. And actually, what we're gonna do now is we're gonna flip it over, give it just a little bit more love. And I'm gonna start in the center, I'm gonna go up, and then I'm gonna go down. And then I'm gonna go up, and then I'm gonna go down. I'm gonna go up, and then I'm gonna go down. And then we're basically there at this point. So I'm just gonna make it look the way I want it. It's looking pretty good. Notice how I'm a little bigger, that's okay. So at this point, we need to get our pan ready. And so to get our pan ready, what I'm gonna do is, since to get it on camera, don't worry, I just ran this through the dishwasher. The bottom of the pan is clean. I'm gonna take a little bit of my olive oil. I'm gonna put it on there. I'm gonna rub the bottom. I'm gonna get every corner. And the olive oil is nice because, one, it's gonna make it from sticking to the pan, I'm gonna get the edges too, but it's also gonna add a nice flavor. Now I'm using a, we have robust olive oil here and it was really strong, so I cut it with just regular oil, and so it's pretty good. So at this point, what I'm going to do is I'm gonna fold, and you wanna do this quickly. So I'm gonna fold the dough in half, I'm gonna fold it in a quarter, I'm gonna move it on here, I'm gonna unfold it. And we probably could have gone a little bigger. Maybe not, but that's pretty good. And so if you kind of put it where you want the pan should be, to be, see how it's like, it's kind of curled up on the edge there. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna lay that edge where I want it and it'll be pretty good. And when you're stretching dough like this, I'm gonna pop all those big bubbles. If you wanna get it more in the corner, what you can do is you can reach way under and you can pull from the center a little bit to get it where you want it, and then just lay it down. And it's a little curled. I'm a little out of practice, but that's okay. Now, if you pull from just the edge, it's gonna get really thin. But there we go. It basically fits to the pan. And so, I'm just gonna take a little bit of olive oil. I'm just gonna... give it a little bit on top. You don't need to do that, but sometimes I do just for flavor. And then what we're going to do now is I have my tomato pie sauce. And so, I'm gonna take some sauce and I'm just going to cover it. Now, you can, in my other video, I let it rise without putting the sauce on it. You let it rise and you put the sauce on it, or you can let it rise with the sauce on it. You can do either way, and normally it works out pretty well. And then all that we're going to do is, and the sauce actually helps create a barrier, so the sauce creates a barrier so it doesn't dry out, if I could find my words. So I'm gonna let this rise for about 45 minutes and then I'm gonna throw it in a 450 degree oven. If the deck oven was turned on, which it is not at the moment, unfortunately the hood we think needs a new motor, so can't use it yet. But soon. Okay, and actually I'm gonna add a little bit more sauce because I think that it's going to soak in. So here it is. Just going to add some more sauce. Actually, I'm gonna add a little bit more right here. And then I'm just gonna cover it with a little bit of saran wrap for the edges. I'm just going to gently put it on top. And part of the reason that I'm doing it this way and not the other way, because I really actually like to put the sauce on it right before I put it in the oven, is because I will be teaching class when I have to put this in the oven, so I can't stop and do it the right way, or the other way. They're both right ways. But I will see you in about 45 minutes before I need to put this in the oven. Okay, so this has been sitting out a little bit. I'm teaching class, and I wish I would have pulled it out 5 minutes earlier, but you can see how much smoother it is. And it's gonna taste great, and I think that we definitely need to put more sauce on it. I wish I could show you the bottom because it's like perfectly GBD. Yeah, needs more sauce, 5 minutes less, and I think that would definitely do it right. Okay, see you in class. Okay, so the last thing I wanna show you is that we cut it, and obviously, could've used a little bit more sauce. But look how light and airy it is. And look at that, like, I call it the goo layer, like on nice thick pizza, like right underneath the sauce. It's just really good. Now we don't, unfortunately we don't have any parm here, but yeah, super good. You guys should make this at home.